So what happens between the input and output phases of our program? Well, this is where we process the data. Once our program receives some input, we're going to need to take that information and perform some type of calculation on that information or process it in some manner. Whether we're receiving that input from a web service or directly from the user, we're always going to want to do something with that data, like determine if the PIN number entered with the card that's currently inserted in the machine is correct. So we need to think about how do we start to process the information that we have to produce the results that we want. And to be honest, this is where the bulk of our work will be this semester. We're going to be performing calculations, and we're going to have a number of mathematical operators available to us to perform those calculations. There's some standard ones that you'll see, like addition, subtraction, multiplication, and some new ones, like the very first item here, exponentiation, which allows us to take a number and raise it to an exponent. And we'll see how to use that as we move forward this semester. Additionally, you're going to note that there are two operators for division. And we'll talk a little more about this as we move forward, but the difference is going to be that one of those operators provides us with a floating point answer, and the other provides us with an integer answer. And so let's talk about that in a second. But first, we want to talk about order of operation and associativity. So one thing to note is that when we're performing calculations in our programs is that the normal mathematical order of operations is observed. So please excuse my dear Aunt Sally, or parentheses, exponentiation, multiplication, division, addition, and subtraction. In other words, we have to pay attention, just like we do in math class, to the order of our operators. We can also use parentheses to reorder things, and we'll see a use of that in the programming sample coming up. Now, in a previous slide, I used a couple of terms. I said integer and float, and you were probably like thinking, well, what is that? So the one thing that I want to stress early on is this concept of what are called data types. And these are essentially the categories of the data that we'll be working with. A data type defines two things. It defines what the data is. In other words, it provides a definition of the data, and what can be done to that data. So specifically, some data types that we will run into constantly this semester. Strings, we've already seen a bunch of them. These are words. They are surrounded by double quotes. They can be composed of zero or more characters. So any word like the letter A or my name, these are strings. So whenever you see words with double quotes in them, we're going to refer to that category of data as a string. The next category that we're going to talk about are called floats or doubles. And for the purpose of this course, both of these categories of data are going to be considered the same, although there is a real difference. One has a higher level of accuracy than the other. But for now, you may just hear me say float or double. But essentially what I mean is any positive or negative number with a decimal point. So any fractional number. Finally, integers. These are going to be positive or negative whole numbers. So any positive number or negative number that does not have a fractional component. So you hear me use the term string, floats or doubles, or integers, and what I'm really referring to are categories of data. Here are some examples of strings, floats, and integers. So notice that all the strings have double quotes around them. Hello, the capital letter A. Notice there's also an empty string in here. There's nothing between the double quotes. And notice that a string can also be a sentence, or it could be the entire text of the Constitution. It could be anything you want it to be, as long as it's inside double quotes and it's any valid, you know, Unicode character. Well, depending on the programming environment. Next up, a couple samples of floats. So numbers like pi, 2.0, negative 32.5. Notice they all have decimal points. And those are good examples of floats. Next up are integers. These are whole numbers. So 0, 2, negative 35, and we'll be using all different, we'll be using these data types over and over again this semester. So again, when I use these terms, note that I'm talking about the category of data in question. One thing to note, do not put commas in large numbers in the programming environments that we are using. So do not type 1,000 with a comma in it. Just type the actual number. I know that that makes it a little more difficult to read, and some languages do have accommodations for this type of notation, but visual logic does not. Earlier on, I talked about there being two different types of division. There are both floating point and integer division. And now that we know a little bit about the difference between floats and ints, we can look at the difference between these different types of division. So a floating point number is any number with a decimal point. So notice if I take the forward slash floating point division operator, so 3 divided by 4 in that context would provide the answer of 0.75. Notice that in the next example, if I use the backslash, which is the integer division operator, 3 backslash division by 4 is going to give me the answer of 0, because you cannot get a whole number by dividing 3 divided by 4. So the problem here is that we end up with 0. We're not allowed with an integer to have a decimal point. And since we can't have a decimal point, what happens is the output is 0. This makes sense because sometimes what we want in terms of performing division is an accurate number, like 0.75. And other times what we want is really just the quotient of a division operator. And there are also ways through another operator that I kind of skipped over in the first slide called mod to demonstrate that we can also get just the remainder of a division operation. So it's pretty cool. We can get the answer of a division operation, we can get the quotient and the remainder specifically if we want them for utilization in our program. So there's a lot of flexibility when it comes to working with operators and especially division. One of the things that's very interesting is that we talked about a little bit earlier on is that when we store something into a variable, whatever was previously in that variable is essentially destroyed. It's overwritten. And that means that variables can only hold one value at a time. And why does this work? How do we use this to our advantage? Well, one of the things that we can do to use this to our advantage is to reuse a variable. And this works because of a concept called associativity, which basically means, do the operators or the operations on a given line of programming happen from right to left, or do they happen from left to right? So is the associativity right to left, or is the associativity left to right? And this is just going to be one of those things that for now we're just, you know, either I'll tell you which way things associate, or, you know, we'll talk about ways that you can look this up. But again, just like having to learn that, you know, multiplication and division happen before addition and subtraction, as you start to write code, you'll learn what is and isn't, you know, or what types of associativity a given operation has. So one of the cool things that we can do here is we can reuse variables because of this idea that storing a value in a variable is a right-to-left operation. So let's take a look at this bit of code that I've got here. Again, we're going to look in this mock programming language that, you know, could be one of any number of languages. So at the top here, I'm going to take the number 1 and I'm going to put it into the variable count. And that itself is a right-to-left operation because the number on the right is stored into the variable on the left. Now, a little bit lower, I'm going to use this to my advantage. I'm going to reuse that variable. So instead of having to create a new one, let's say I want to just constantly add one to a variable, something we do often, something we do quite often in programs is count things. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, how many of these things are there? And in this case, what'll happen is this entire expression, the items on the right will happen first, and then the answer will be saved back into the variable on the left. So in this specific case, the value held in count is 1. We'll add 1 to it, so we get the answer 2, and then 2 will be stored into the value or the variable count. All right, if the value in count was 2, 2 plus 1 would be 3, and then 3 will get stored into the value count. The idea being that everything on the right-hand side of this assignment operator, or the equal sign, is calculated first, and then everything that the answer of that expression is then stored into the variable on the left, because assignment, when we see a single equal sign, that is an assignment operation, the assignment operation has right-to-left associativity. One thing that's important to stress, I talked earlier on about how strings have double quotes around them, and this is really how the programming environment can tell the difference between words meant for the human and variables or programming statements meant for the programming environment. So in this specific example, I have a variable named temperature, and I have a string named temperature, and the only way the computer can tell them apart is by the double quotes. So the variable temperature is a storage location in which I can hold values. The string temperature is a word that is probably intended to be printed out to the end user. So it's important that you understand the difference between how a programming environment can determine the difference between a variable and a string. And in those cases, it's going to be double quotes. So let's see the application of some of these concepts in our programming environment, Visual Logic. I'm going to start with our Hello Name program. And what we're going to do here is we're going to basically add a new variable, and we're going to get the input for that variable from the user. So I'm going to use another input block here. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask the user to enter a temperature in Fahrenheit. So I'm going to say temp f as the variable name to indicate that this is a temperature and it's in Fahrenheit. I could type out temperature Fahrenheit, but that's a lot to type. All right, so then we're going to say please enter a temp in f in Fahrenheit. And I'm cheating a little bit. I should probably use full words and make that a lot easier to follow, but this is a pretty basic program, and I can, I'm going to limit that and just kind of make it easy to fit on the screen. Next up, I want to add an assignment operator. And so this is going to be a new block that we're going to be using in Visual Logic. And the assignment block is going to be one of the components that we use for this processing of the information that we are bringing in from the user or from some other location or whatever. So we're going to be using one or more of these assignment blocks in our programs, in many cases, to perform calculations. So I'm going to double-click this, and you'll note that this looks an awful lot like what we've previously used. And I'll put it down here so it's a little bit easier to see everything prior to this. So note that I have input, and the value that the user enters in Fahrenheit is going to be stored in the tempf variable. So down here, what I want to do is I'm going to create a new variable called tempc. Because what I want to do is execute an expression on the right-hand side, get the value that is produced by that expression, and store it into the variable tempc so I can use it later. Notice that we're doing a lot of calculations and then storing the answers in variables for use later. Anything of interest I want to hold on to and use at a later date in my program, I put into a variable. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to set up the calculation for making this conversion. So there's a couple of things that we can do here. I'm going to basically, you know, that if you take Fahrenheit, subtract 32, and then multiply by 5 divided by 9, we get the appropriate answer. And so what I'm going to do here is use my variable tempf, because tempf is the value that the user entered, and it should be a temperature in Fahrenheit. I'm then going to subtract 32 from that value. And I'm going to use parentheses here to make sure that the order of the operations is correct. Why? Because for this to actually work, then we also need to multiply by 5 divided by 9. And this should give us the appropriate answer. If you want, we could also wrap this in parentheses. It's not required, but it can make it more readable. Notice that I can put spaces in between each one of these operators, and there's not a problem, right? I can have these all bunched up together, which I would not recommend because it's fatiguing on your eyes and can be a little more difficult to read. So what I like to do is space things out so it's easier to read. We want to try to make sure that our brain is not getting tired having to do things like look at tightly spaced letters. We want to save all of our brain cycles for actual programming and coding challenges. So in this case, I think I've got a pretty good calculation here. And you'll note that, you know, I'm using parentheses to group these. Notice there's the multiplication operator. Also notice that I'm using the forward slash division operator because I want to get the answer to this division operation. I'm not interested in specifically the remainder or the quotient. So in this specific case, I think we're good to go. So this is the expression that will be evaluated. It's going to get the value that the user entered out of this variable, and the answer will get saved into this variable. Everything on the right will happen first, and then the assignment to the variable on the left will occur last. And if we want to see the answer, we can go into our output block, and we can put that in here. And what I'll do is put my concatenation operator, and I will say, let's see, your temp in F, and I'll print that back out to the user. Oops. And note, you know, it's fine to make typos. Everybody makes typos. Oop, converted to C is. And then we will put the answer to our calculation. So it'll say, hello, your name, your temp in Fahrenheit, print out the temp, converted to Celsius is, and let's get rid of these colons because I probably don't need them. And notice that between each one of these strings, I've got the ampersand because I'm gluing strings to the values and variables, and I'm building a custom output message. And now we see that that works. Let's go ahead and run this. See if I made any mistakes. Enter my name. Remember, whenever we enter strings, we put them in double quotes. And then I'm going to enter a temperature in Fahrenheit. So we'll go 32. And that's a good way to test is use some known variables. And what we get as an answer is, hello, Jason. Your temp in Fahrenheit 32 converted to Celsius is 0, which sounds right to me. So notice I missed a space in here. I would have to put a space after my exclamation point to make that look a little bit better. I also forgot to put a zero or a period at the end of my sentence. Those things, again, would require just some modifications to my output string. But overall, you can see how, in this case, we're now not just getting input and producing output. We're getting input from the user, performing calculations with that input, and then we're building some customized output with the results of that calculation.